deepest tunes, the warmest memories. Radio Nostalgia from Mars.
Well, that brings us to the end of the show. It's been a real journey. Music, stories, and memories. Radio Nostalgia from Mars has it all. If you want to be involved with RNFM, have a story to tell, a memory to share, contact us via the usual internet channels and leave a short message outlining your contribution. Once your story idea is vetted and greenlit by corporate, we'll track you down to organize a time to record you. Please note that not all stories are accepted, and we are not permitted to give out criteria, so stories and ideas are submitted at your own risk. A big thank you to our show sponsor, OMAS, the no-stress, no-fuss drink for the ultra-elite. And a big thank you to corporate for allocating us this precious time and their resources on this tight beam to you. I hope you've enjoyed the show. It's been a pleasure to take your hand. We're playing out with Crowded in My Mind, a song that always reminds us that no matter how cramped and stuffy we feel, in the end, there is always a breath of fresh air in memories of blue skies.
Musica è stare in Dobridana. Radio Nostalgia Samas.
Crowds in New York, crowds in Berlin, crowds in Tokyo, Paris, London, Shanghai, Belgrade, Rio, Bombay, Mexico City, Moscow. Crowded on the screens, crowds on the phones, crowds at the papers, crowded sounds at the wind. It's crowded in our minds. Thank you.
by for next transmission. Please stand by for next transmission in 30 seconds. Please stand by for next transmission in 20 seconds. In 15 seconds. In 10 seconds. In 5 seconds. In 1 second.
Ya to all you Martians out there, welcome to another edition of Nostalgia from Mars. Plenty of great stuff coming your way onto Sol's show. You know, bit of that old Terran flavor. Some more stories from our beloved callers. And news and views from around our base out here among the stars. Like I said, your tight beam to Radio Nostalgia from Mars. Breathe easy, kick back, and reminisce. Classic Proto 2021. long-lost Earth Day anthem recently discovered in the archives here on Mars. That should take most of us back to the days when Mars was nothing but an evening star in the sky, and large social gatherings were still normal and carefree. Speaking of carefree, look out for three new OMAS flavors, pink, green, and yellow. Pure calm in a tube. Right, moving on. As always, we've collected some stories from our beloved callers, and up first is a young man who might just be the luckiest one of us all.
События, воспоминания, старые добрые времена, оригинальные источники, подлинные истории, надежда, вдохновение, драма, радионостальгия с Марса.
I nearly missed the boat to Mars. I mean, the rumors about something big happening in Alphaville had been floating for a few years, and of course it was impossible to separate fact from fiction. At that time, I barely made it through insurgent territory to this floating ghetto about an hour away from Alphaville by motorboat. I won't go into detail, but the crew I ran with bribed an outpost guard to go have a really long piss, while we used his comms to access their infranet. Their information turned out just as distorted as ours, but we found one channel that changed everything. Some bright spark in Alphaville had made color-coded spreadsheets of shipping data a monkey could understand. Imports into Alphaville were off the charts, while exports had zeroed out completely. I mean, nothing was coming out, even on the black market, which incidentally was fully accounted for, meaning it had to be sanctioned all along. So we knew something was up. Of course Alphaville Media spun this situation heavily. The insurgents were blamed for everything, disrupting supply lines, stealing aid and so on. But it was really Alphaville stockpiling on a scale unseen in modern history. What tipped us off that they were planning to leave Earth is what they were stockpiling. Fuel, fuel, fuel. Specifically, dinitrogen, tetroxide and hydrazine. Old school. But they're chemicals used as rocket fuel. They're easy to store, but they're highly toxic and require careful handling, which explained another gruesome discovery. The covert shipping and dumping of bodies. A lot of bodies. There were so many that some of those bodies had started washing up in our neighborhood. So toxic, even scavengers stayed away. Coincidentally, it suddenly became much easier to get a multi-day work pass into Alphaville. We were so hungry and focused on other resources, we didn't make the connection. We assumed the workers were skipping on the visa. In fact, I was planning to do the exact same thing. So actually, I lucked out. I'm a small guy, and Alphaville was so strapped for labor at that point that I was given an unscreened pass and ended up in heavy labor, moving enormous containers into storage with mechanical suits, but it didn't fit them. So I was just given a scanner instead and told to scan serial numbers all day. It was very hard to breathe, so I traded for a spare hazmat suit from a drunk guard and put it on. Not unusual at all to hang out all day in a hazy. Technically just walking outside required one those days. That's what saved me, twice. Whew, I mean, hindsight is 20/20, but those containers were the rocket fuel. And in no way was it being stored and transported safely. All those guys died, withered to skin and bone, nasty stuff. Again, it was all hidden in plain sight. Hell, we were all skin and bone at that point. We just assumed everyone was starving. I only got onto one of the last ships up to Mars because I was in a hazmat suit and holding that scanner, which I think had stopped working within the first days of my assignment. I never told anyone, and no one ever asked. I guess I was confused with security or something. All I remember is being yelled at, rushed into a shuttle, and then everyone patting me on the back and calling me Scully. The name embedded in the biometrics of the suit. I never saw my crew or this guy again.
Wow, what amazing luck to be in the right suit at the right time. Just goes to show, dressing appropriately for the job can really go a long way. Speaking of dressing appropriately, here's a Mars fun fact. Despite an average temperature of well below minus 80 degrees centigrade, if you step outside without a suit on, you won't freeze to death, your blood will boil. That's due to the low atmospheric pressure outside. So please maintain your suits properly and follow decontamination protocols strictly at all times when returning from extra habitat activities. No suit, no life, as we say.
Radio Nostalgia from Mars.
Right, how about a 21st century love song remixed for the 22nd? Who's watching who? Espionage or true love? I guess we'll never really be quite sure. Surveillance love song, an oldie but a goodie. Sophie Jazz reminding us that love remains as complicated as ever, despite our patented matchmaking algorithms and genetic profiling. On the subject of complications, the Mars Time conglomerate has asked me to mention that even though a Mars sol is 40 minutes longer than a day on Earth, you do not have to manually add 40 minutes to your clocks every sol. We are officially on Mars clock time. So every second, minute, and hour across all systems and devices are 2.7% longer by design. I know it's confusing at first, but just keep time as usual. For all practical purposes, we live a 24-hour day up here, just like we did on Earth.
Слушайте, Radio Nostalgia from Mars.
Okay, on with the show. Well, we've had a few requests for some classical music, and boy do I have a double treat for all you classical and vinyl lovers out there. A genuine record playing off an actual record player on loan from a dedicated RNFM fan. So grab a tube of OMS, sit back, and enjoy some chill, neoclassical vibes with that warm vinyl sound right here on Radio Nostalgia from Mars.
Take a moment, relax, and remember, with Radio Nostalgia from Mars.
Музика и стари добри дана. Радио Носталгия Самарс.
From neoclassical to electronica, we really do have it all here on Radio Nostalgia from Mars. First we heard an original vinyl with music from an unknown composer, lost to time, I'm afraid. All I can say is it's a white label test pressing found in a recycling bin with just the word Aftermath written across the label. After that we got the Blood Pumping with an upbeat tune from Polytech AD and their classic tune, Do You Love Me? Want to keep that blood pumping? Remember, exercise is mandatory. No groans, no bones. And mental exercise is just as important, so get on down to your local rec center for a dose of mentally stimulating team activities and some delicious OMS. Okay, on to our next caller for the show. Manu reminds us that one person's pleasure is another person's pain, and that we might not all relax in the same way to the same things.
I go back in a heartbeat. Tesla City is unbearable. As far as I'm concerned, this promised land is anything but a dictatorship without oxygen. All these daily routines and protocols about everything we took for granted on Earth are so exhausting. Is it safe to take off your hazmat to breathe? Is the water distilled from all our urine really safe? And exactly what behavior will trigger a social credit demotion? Not to mention, every sneeze is suspect. The whole dome has to be sanitized if someone even sniffles. You'd think we figured it out during the pandemics. I know social distancing up here is impossible, but how freaking difficult is it to keep your hands clean and just not sneeze on stuff? Anyway, maybe that's humanity in a nutshell. After all, we walked on the moon before really learning to walk on Earth. I digress. I just want to say that the effort put into maintaining basic life functions in this state-of-the-art society outweighs the benefit of being alive. Use your head, can't you? Use your head. You're on Earth, there's no cure for that. Sam Beckett wrote that in Endgame. We're not cured, regardless of what our de facto overlords claim. It's ironic that the only thing we managed to export culturally onto another planet is a Silicon Valley brand of Protestantism. Sorry for rambling. Anyway, I called into the program to share some Earth sounds I captured. I'm sure listeners of RNFM who suffer from nostalgia like me will appreciate them. In the meditation dome, we can listen to the light sounds of the Tuscan country, the olive grove shores of Kefalonia, the blue Danube below the Schwarzwald. I went to the meditation dome a few times, but just like yoga, I can't stand it. Simply, I don't miss nature at all. I was never a nature person, never really liked hiking or camping. I miss the city. This whole predicament started because we mixed with wilderness in the first place. This bullshit about Mother Nature sugarcoated the fact that maybe we were supposed to keep a sharp boundary between ourselves and the wild. And now, we're demoted from Earthling to miserable Martian status. So at the end of every day, I escape into texts I brought along, I drink that horrid canteen coffee, and listen to urban sounds I recorded 15 years ago, mostly in New York and London. Here are some of my favorite sounds. Here's the sound of my bicycle rolling down the street. Bustling city in the morning, a call and response of cars and birds. And the giggling of my kids in Washington Square as a group of street performers play the boombox and do tricks. Thank you. going off and the smell of Turkish coffee. And for some reason, I'm obsessed with the sound of the New York MTA.
第二の故郷ラジオノスタルジアフロムマーズ。
Thank you, Mania, for sharing both your thoughts and your favorite sounds with us. That MTA recording actually got me digging into my proverbial record crate because it reminded me of this old track from my DJing days back on Earth called Tokyo 320, a minimal tech house homage to life in the commute and traveling while standing still. Wonderful stuff. Not so wonderful, though, is a spate of ecoplastic stockpiling occurring in sectors 7 through 12 after rumors of a pending shortage. Guys, ecoplastic items are freely dispensed at conveniently located kiosks around Tesla City, so there's simply no need to hoard any ecoplastic items. In fact, hoarding them deprives the 3D printers of the recyclable material they need to make them freely available. So your stockpiling is kind of defeating the point of renewable resources. There's a 14 sol grace period to return all parts not in use. No questions asked. Besides, however much you hold on, there's just one thing you can't stockpile.
Radio Nostalgia z Marsa.
There, reminding us that all the good things in the world are no substitute for love. So if you've recently matched with someone via our repopulation program and you've received a date for your first meetup, don't forget to add it to your mandatory diary. There does seem to be some confusion about scheduling based on the new double month standard, but it's really quite simple, guys. There are now 24 months in our year, and there are two of each month, January 1 and January 2, February 1 and February 2, and so on. Each month is now 28 sols long, except for every 6th month, which is 27 sols long. I hope that clears up the situation. Any further queries, in writing please, can be submitted directly to the Mars Coalition for the simplification of the Martian calendar. So, from trains and city soundscapes to rhythms born out of hands and feet, water and drums, we continue our journey into the past, into our collective memories of Earth, a celebration of sound as music, music as sound, and voices that carry us into the stars. In that vein, a friendly reminder that silence is deadly. If you hear nothing, please report it. General machine noise means we are being kept alive. Speaking of keeping us alive, 2 equals 1. duplicates are not spares, people. Everything on Mars is duplicated for security, so please do not cannibalize existing tech. If something breaks, head directly to the spares and parts department in Sector 5 to submit your report and apply for official replacements. Kohler, a senior geologist at Tesla University, gives us a slightly different perspective on ecology from his research lab at the South Pole.
思い出、エピソード、あの頃の記憶、古き良き、時代の話、希望、きらめき、出来事、ラジオ、ノスタルジア、フロムマーズ。
As a geologist, it always annoyed me that the cover of Earth conservation was not needed. But seen from space, the majority of the Earth's surface is land, with the remaining 29% for land. And of that land, deserts make up one third of the land surface area, sweeping burns of oak, rust, gold, and chrome. It'd break. Anyway, as a lifelong acolyte of sun and sand, I'm not up here pining for jungles and wetlands. I yearn for week-long expeditions into the desert, traversing dunes big enough to swallow entire towns in one sideways drift. Oh, to feel that oven-hot wind dry as a bone on my face. There's more dust in my veins than water, I can tell you that much. It astonishes me that people up here are oblivious to the fact that it's our understanding of living in deserts that makes life up here on Mars even possible. The early days of Mars habitation experiments took place in the Gobi Desert and in Hawaii on the side of a barren volcano, not in a protected marshland in the Okavango. You get me? What did the last trees of the Black Forest give us except fuel for our final purpose? The desert saved us. Oh, I mean, the irony is not lost on me, but no Sahara, no Amazon, no Gobi, no Mars. Where do you think the Amazon Basin was getting all its fertile sand from? Blown over from Africa, that's where. How do we know how to recycle water to near 99% efficiency? The Gobi Desert. There was always so much focus on saving the planet, saving the whales, saving bees, saving the trees. The deserts, am I right? Make them green. I knew it was over when those idiots deliberately tried to flood parts of the Sahara with one species of tree. I mean, come on. A publicity stunt by a French paper manufacturer with deeper pockets. And no one blinked an eye. It was meant to help, but the Sahara Tree Project literally poured salt into the wound. It started out well enough, but some unknown fungus wiped them all out, but not before they had sucked all the fertile phosphorus out of the sand blowing over the Atlantic. Effectively salting the Amazon basin like an Italian grandmother making tomato sauce. And then there was no turning back. Deserts are why we exist at all, you know. Now as much as then, so history repeats itself. To paraphrase geologist William Grabo, the ancestors of modern man did not leave the trees left them. So, are we then the neo-great apes leaving the proverbial trees? The stars, our new savannah? From that perspective, we didn't leave Earth so much as Earth left us. The desert was always one step ahead, and in a way, we started living on Mars before we even left.
Ah yes, not all of us up here pine for the fjords. Put me in the desert camp for sure. That searing blue sky and endless horizon. I'm still not used to how close the horizon here is on Mars, and the strange sky still throws me off when I see it, and apparently I'm not the only one. The Recreation and Relaxation Department has asked me to remind those complaining about the red color filter on the windows of the panorama observation deck that the sky on Mars is not blue, but salmon pink. So please bear that in mind when submitting your request to visit the outer domes. And also bear in mind that the waiting list is now double months long, so book early for the experience. You're tight beamed to Radio Nostalgia from Mars. Let's take a trip into the desert.